This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, 10 Years Later by Alexandre Dumas. Introduction. In the months of March to July in 1844, in the magazine Le Siècle, the first portion of a story appeared, penned by the celebrated playwright Alexandre Dumas. It was based, he claimed, on some manuscripts he had found a year earlier in the Bibliothèque Nationale while researching a history he planned to write on Louis XV. They chronicled the adventures of a young man named D'Artagnan, who, upon entering Paris, became almost immediately embroiled in court intrigues, international politics, and ill-fated affairs between royal lovers. Over the next 6 years, readers would enjoy the adventures of this youth and his three famous friends, Porthos, Athos, and Aramis, as their exploits unraveled behind the scenes of some of the most momentous events in French and even English history. Eventually, these serialized adventures were published in novel form and became the three D'Artagnan romances known today. Here is a brief summary of the first two novels. The Three Musketeers, serialized March to July 1844. The year is 1625. The young D'Artagnan arrives in Paris at the tender age of 18 and almost immediately offends three musketeers, Porthos, Aramis, and Athos. Instead of dueling, the four are attacked by five of the cardinal's guards, and the courage of the youth is made apparent during the battle. The four become fast friends, and when asked by D'Artagnan's landlord to find his missing wife, embark upon an adventure that takes them across both France and England in order to thwart the plans of the Cardinal Richelieu. Along the way, they encounter a beautiful young spy, named simply Milady, who will stop at nothing to disgrace Queen Anne of Austria before her husband Louis XIII, and take her revenge upon the four friends. 20 years after, serialized January-August, 1845, the year is now 1648, 20 years since the close of the last story. Louis XIII has died, as has Cardinal Richelieu, and while the crown of France may sit upon the head of Anne of Austria as regent for the young Louis XV, the real power resides with the Cardinal Mazarin, her secret husband. D'Artagnan is now a lieutenant of musketeers, and his three friends have retired to private life. Athos turned out to be a nobleman, the Comte de la Fère, and has retired to his home with his son, Raoul de Bragelon. Aramis, whose real name is D'Herblay, has followed his intention of shedding the musketeer's cassock for the priest's robes, and Porthos has married a wealthy woman who left him her fortune upon her death. But trouble is stirring in both France and England. Cromwell menaces the institution of royalty itself while marching against Charles I, and at home, the Fronde is threatening to tear France apart. D'Artagnan brings his friends out of retirement to save the threatened English monarch, but Mordaunt, the son of Milady, who seeks to avenge his mother's death at the musketeers' hands, thwarts their valiant efforts. Undaunted, our heroes return to France just in time to help save the young Louis XV, quiet the Fronde, and tweak the nose of Cardinal Mazarin. The third novel, The Vicomte de Bragelonne, serialized October 1847 January 1850, has enjoyed a strange history in its English translation. It has been split into three, four, or five volumes at various points in its history. The five-volume edition generally does not give titles to the smaller portions, but the others do. In the three-volume edition, the novels are entitled The Vicomte de Bragelonne, Louise de la Valliere, and The Man in the Iron Mask. For the purposes of this e-text, I have chosen to split the novel as the four-volume edition does, with these titles: The Vicomte de Bragelonne, 10 years later, Louise de la Valliere, and The Man in the Iron Mask. In the last e-text, The Vicomte de Bragelonne, e-text 2609. It is the year 1660, and D'Artagnan, after 35 years of loyal service, has become disgusted with serving King Louis XV, while the real power resides with the Cardinal Mazarin, and has tendered his resignation. He embarks on his own project, that of restoring Charles II to the throne of England, and with the help of Athos, succeeds, earning himself quite a fortune in the process. D'Artagnan returns to Paris to live the life of a rich citizen, and Athos, after negotiating the marriage of Philip, the king's brother, to Princess Henrietta of England, likewise retires to his own estate, La Fere. Meanwhile, Mazarin has finally died, and left Louis to assume the reins of power with the assistance of M. Colbert, formerly Mazarin's trusted clerk. Colbert has an intense hatred for M. Fouquet, the king's superintendent of finances, and has resolved to use any means necessary to bring about his fall. With the new rank of intendant bestowed on him by Louis, Colbert succeeds in having two of Fouquet's loyal friends tried and executed. He then brings to the king's attention that Fouquet is fortifying the island of Belle-Île-en-Mer, and could possibly be planning to use it as a base for some military operation against the king. Louis calls D'Artagnan out of retirement and sends him to investigate the island, promising him a tremendous salary and his long-promised promotion to captain of the musketeers upon his return. At Belle Isle, D'Artagnan discovers that the engineer of the fortifications is, in fact, Porthos, now the Baron du Vallon, and that's not all. The blueprints for the island, although in Porthos's handwriting, show evidence of another script that has been erased, that of Aramis. D'Artagnan later discovers that Aramis has become the Bishop of Vannes, which is, coincidentally, a parish belonging to M. Fouquet. Suspecting that D'Artagnan has arrived on the king's behalf to investigate, Aramis tricks D'Artagnan into wandering around Vannes in search of Porthos, and sends Porthos on an heroic ride back to Paris to warn Fouquet of the danger. Fouquet rushes to the king and gives him Belle Isle as a present, thus allaying any suspicion and at the same time humiliating Colbert, just minutes before the usher announces someone else seeking an audience with the king. And now, the second e-text of the Vicomte de Bragelonne. Enjoy. John Bercy Mordaunt. There is one French custom that may cause confusion. The Duc d'Orléans is traditionally called Monsieur, and his wife Madame. Gaston, the king's uncle, currently holds that title. Upon the event of his death, it will be conferred upon the king's brother, Philip, who is currently the Duc d'Anjou. The customary title of Monsieur will go to him as well, and upon his future wife, Henrietta of England, that of Madame. Gaston's widow will be referred to as the Dowager Madame. J.B. End of the introduction. Chapter 1, in which D'Artagnan finishes by at length placing his hand upon his captain's commission. The reader guesses beforehand whom the usher preceded in announcing the courier from Britannia. This messenger was easily recognized. It was D'Artagnan, his clothes dusty, his face inflamed, his hair dripping with sweat, his legs stiff. He lifted his feet painfully at every step on which resounded the clink of his blood-stained spurs. He perceived in the doorway he was passing through the superintendent coming out. Fouquet bowed with a smile to him, who an hour before was bringing him ruin and death. D'Artagnan found in his goodness of heart, and in his inexhaustible vigor of body, enough presence of mind to remember the kind reception of this man. He bowed then also much more from benevolence and compassion than from respect. He felt upon his lips the word which had so many times been repeated to the Duc de Guise, fly. But to pronounce that word would have been to betray his cause. To speak that word in the cabinet of the king, and before an usher, would have been to ruin himself gratuitously, and could save nobody. D'Artagnan then contented himself with bowing to Fouquet and entered. At this moment, the king floated between the joy the last words of Fouquet had given him, and his pleasure at the return of D'Artagnan. Without being a courtier, D'Artagnan had a glance as sure and as rapid as if he had been one. He read on his entrance, devouring humiliation on the countenance of Colbert. He even heard the king say these words to him. Ah! Monsieur Colbert, you have then 900,000 livres at the intendant's? Colbert, suffocated, bowed but made no reply. All this scene entered into the mind of D'Artagnan by the eyes and ears at once. The first word of Louis to his musketeer, as if he wished it to contrast with what he was saying at the moment, was a kind good day. His second was to send away Colbert. The latter left the king's cabinet, pallid and tottering, whilst D'Artagnan twisted up the ends of his mustache. "I love to see one of my servants in this disorder," said the king, admiring the martial stains upon the clothes of his envoy. "I thought, sire, my presence at the Louvre was sufficiently urgent to excuse my presenting myself thus before you. You bring me great news, then, monsieur?" "Sire, the thing is this, in two words. Belle Isle is fortified, admirably fortified. Belle Isle has a double enceinte, a citadel, two detached forts, its ports contain three corsairs, and the side batteries only await their cannon." "I know all that, monsieur," replied the king. "What, your majesty knows all that?" replied the musketeer, stupefied. "I have the plan of the fortifications of Belle Isle," said the king. "Your majesty has the plan?" "Here it is." "It is really correct, sire. I saw a similar one on the spot." D'Artagnan's brow became clouded. "Ah! I understand all. Your majesty did not trust to me alone, but sent some other person," said he in a reproachful tone. "Of what importance is the manner, monsieur, in which I have learnt what I know so that I know it?" "Sire, sire," said the musketeer, without seeking even to conceal his dissatisfaction, "but I must be permitted to say to your majesty that it is not worth while to make me use such speed, to risk 20 times the breaking of my neck, to salute me on my arrival with such intelligence." "Sire, when people are not trusted or are deemed insufficient, they should scarcely be employed." And D'Artagnan, with a movement perfectly military, stamped with his foot and left upon the floor dust stained with blood. The king looked at him, inwardly enjoying his first triumph. "Monsieur," said he at the expiration of a minute, "not only is Belle Isle known to me, but still further, Belle Isle is mine."
That is well, sire. I ask but one thing more," replied D'Artagnan.
"My discharge."
"What, your discharge?"
"Without doubt I am too proud to eat the bread of the king without earning it, or rather by gaining it badly."
"My discharge, sire."
"Oh, oh.
I ask for my discharge, or I will take it."
"You are angry, monsieur?"
"I have reason, mordieu. 32 hours in the saddle, I ride day and night, I perform prodigies of speed, I arrive stiff as the corpse of a man who has been hung, and another arrives before me. Come, sire, I am a fool."
"My discharge, sire."
"Monsieur D'Artagnan," said Louis, leaning his white hand upon the dusty arm of the musketeer, "what I tell you will not at all affect that which I promised you. A king's word given must be kept." And the king, going straight to his table, opened a drawer and took out a folded paper. "Here is your commission of captain of musketeers. You have won it, Monsieur D'Artagnan." D'Artagnan opened the paper eagerly and scanned it twice. He could scarcely believe his eyes.
"And this commission is given you," continued the king, "not only on account of your journey to Belle Isle, but moreover, for your brave intervention at the Place de Grève. There likewise you served me valiantly."
"Ah, ah," said D'Artagnan, without his self-command being able to prevent a blush from mounting to his eyes, "you know that also, sire?"
"Yes, I know it." The king possessed a piercing glance and an infallible judgment when it was his object to read men's minds.
"You have something to say," said he to the musketeer, "something to say which you do not say. Come, speak freely, monsieur. You know that I told you once and for all that you are to be always quite frank with me."
"Well, sire, what I have to say is this, that I would prefer being made captain of the musketeers for having charged a battery at the head of my company, or taken a city, than for causing two wretches to be hung."
"Is this quite true, you tell me?"
"And why should your majesty suspect me of dissimulation, I ask?"
"Because I have known you well, monsieur. You cannot repent of having drawn your sword for me."
"Well, in that your majesty is deceived, and greatly. Yes, I do repent of having drawn my sword on account of the results that action produced. The poor men who were hung, sire, were neither your enemies nor mine, and they could not defend themselves."
The king preserved silence for a moment. And your companion, M. D'Artagnan, does he partake of your repentance?
My companion?
Yes, you were not alone, I have been told.
Alone where?
At the Place de Grève.
No, sire, no, said D'Artagnan, blushing at the idea that the king might have a suspicion that he, D'Artagnan, had wished to engross to himself all the glory that belonged to Raoul.
No, mordieu, and as your majesty says, I had a companion, and a good companion too.
A young man?
Yes, sire, a young man.
Oh.
Your majesty must accept my compliments. You are as well informed of things out of doors as things within. It is M. Colbert, who makes all these fine reports to the king.
M. Colbert has said nothing but good of you, M. D'Artagnan, and he would have met with a bad reception if he had come to tell me anything else.
That is fortunate.
But he also said much good of that young man.
And with justice, said the musketeer.
In short, it appears that this young man is a fire-eater, said Louis, in order to sharpen the sentiment which he mistook for envy.
A fire-eater?
Yes, sire, repeated D'Artagnan, delighted on his part to direct the king's attention to Raoul.
Do you not know his name?
Well, I think.
You know him, then?
I have known him nearly 25 years, sire.
Why, he is scarcely 25 years old, cried the king.
Well, sire, I have known him ever since he was born, that is all.
Do you affirm that?
Sire, said D'Artagnan, your majesty questions me with a mistrust in which I recognize another character than your own.
M. Colbert, who has so well informed you, has he not forgotten to tell you that this young man is the son of my most intimate friend?
The Vicomte de Bragelonne?
Certainly, sire.
The father of the Vicomte de Bragelonne is M. le Comte de la Fère, who so powerfully assisted in the restoration of King Charles II. Bragelonne comes of a valiant race, sire.
Then he is the son of that nobleman who came to me, or rather to M. Mazarin, on the part of King Charles II, to offer me his alliance?
Exactly, sire.
And the Comte de la Fère is a great soldier, say you?
Sire, he is a man who has drawn his sword more times for the king, your father, than there are at present months in the happy life of your majesty.
It was Louis XV who now bit his lip.
That is well, M. D'Artagnan, very well.
And M. le Comte de la Fère is your friend, say you?
For about 40 years, yes, sire.
Your majesty may see that I do not speak to you of yesterday.
Should you be glad to see this young man, M. D'Artagnan?
Delighted, sire.
The king touched his bell, and an usher appeared.
Call M. de Bragelonne, said the king.
Ah, he is here, said D'Artagnan.
He is on guard today, at the Louvre, with the company of the gentlemen of Monsieur le Prince.
The king had scarcely ceased speaking when Raoul presented himself, and on seeing D'Artagnan, smiled on him with that charming smile which is only found upon the lips of youth.
Come, come, said D'Artagnan familiarly to Raoul, the king will allow you to embrace me, only tell his majesty you thank him.
Raoul bowed so gracefully that Louis, to whom all superior qualities were pleasing when they did not overshadow his own, admired his beauty, strength, and modesty.
Monsieur, said the king, addressing Raoul, I have asked Monsieur le Prince to be kind enough to give you up to me. I have received his reply, and you belong to me from this morning.
Monsieur le Prince was a good master, but I hope you will not lose by the exchange.
Yes, yes, Raoul, be satisfied. The king has some good in him, said D'Artagnan, who had fathomed the character of Louis, and who played with his self-love within certain limits, always observing, be it understood, the proprieties and flattering, even when he appeared to be bantering.
Sire, said Bragelonne, with voice soft and musical, and with the natural and easy elocution he inherited from his father, sire, it is not from today that I belong to your majesty.
Oh,
no, I know, said the king. You mean your enterprise of the Grève.
That day you were truly mine, monsieur.
Sire, it is not of that day I would speak. It would not become me to refer to so paltry a service in the presence of such a man as M. D'Artagnan. I would speak of a circumstance which created an epoch in my life, and which consecrated me, from the age of 16, to the devoted service of your majesty."
"Ah, ah," said the king, "what was that circumstance? Tell me, monsieur."
"This is it, sire. When I was setting out on my first campaign, that is to say, to join the army of Monsieur le Prince, M. le Comte de la Fere came to conduct me as far as Saint-Denis, where the remains of King Louis XIII wait upon the lowest steps of the funeral basilique, a successor whom God will not send him, I hope, for many years. Then he made me swear upon the ashes of our masters to serve royalty, represented by you incarnate in you, sire, to serve it in word, in thought, and in action. I swore, and God and the dead were witnesses to my oath. During 10 years, sire, I have not so often as I desired had occasion to keep it. I am a soldier of your majesty, and nothing else, and on calling me nearer to you, I do not change my master, I only change my garrison." Raoul was silent and bowed. Louis still listened, after he had done speaking.
"Mordieu," cried D'Artagnan, "that was well spoken, was it not, your majesty?
A good race, a noble race."
"Yes," murmured the king, without, however, daring to manifest his emotion, for it had no other cause than contact with a nature intrinsically noble.
"Yes, monsieur, you say truly, wherever you were the king's. But in changing your garrison, believe me, you will find an advancement of which you are worthy." Raoul saw that this ended what the king had to say to him. And with the perfect tact which characterized his refined nature, he bowed and retired.
"Is there anything else, monsieur, of which you have to inform me?" said the king, when he found himself again alone with D'Artagnan.
"Yes, sire, and I kept that news for the last, for it is sad, and will clothe European royalty in mourning."
"What do you tell me?"
"Sire, in passing through Blois, a word, a sad word, echoed from the palace struck my ear."
"In truth, you terrify me, M. D'Artagnan."
"Sire, this word was pronounced to me by a picor who wore crepe on his arm."
"My uncle Gaston of Orleans, perhaps?"
"Sire, he has rendered his last sigh."
"And I was not warned of it," cried the king, whose royal susceptibility saw an insult in the absence of this intelligence.
"Oh, do not be angry, sire," said D'Artagnan. "Neither the couriers of Paris nor the couriers of the whole world can travel with your servant. The courier from Blois will not be here these 2 hours, and he rides well, I assure you, seeing that I only passed him on the thither side of Orleans."
"My uncle Gaston," murmured Louis, pressing his hand to his brow, and comprising in those 3 words all that his memory recalled of that symbol of opposing sentiments.
"Eh, yes, sire, it is thus," said D'Artagnan, philosophically replying to the royal thought, "it is thus the past flies away."
"That is true, monsieur, that is true, but there remains for us, thank God, the future, and we will try to make it not too dark."
"I feel confidence in your majesty on that head," said D'Artagnan, bowing. "And now?"
"You are right, monsieur. I had forgotten the 100 leagues you have just ridden.
Go, monsieur, take care of one of the best of soldiers, and when you have reposed a little, come and place yourself at my disposal."
"Sire, absent or present, I am always yours."
D'Artagnan bowed and retired. Then, as if he had only come from Fontainebleau, he quickly traversed the Louvre to rejoin Bragelon. End of the chapter. Chapter 2. A Lover and His Mistress. Whilst the waxlights were burning in the castle of Blois, around the inanimate body of Gaston of Orleans, that last representative of the past, whilst the bourgeois of the city were thinking out his epitaph, which was far from being a panegyric, whilst Madame the Dowager, no longer remembering that in her young days she had loved that senseless corpse to such a degree as to fly the paternal palace for his sake, was making within 20 paces of the funeral apartment her little calculations of interest and her little sacrifices of pride. Other interests and other prides were in agitation in all the parts of the castle into which a living soul could penetrate. Neither the lugubrious sounds of the bells, nor the voices of the chanters, nor the splendor of the wax lights through the windows, nor the preparations for the funeral, had power to divert the attention of two persons, placed at a window of the interior court, a window that we are acquainted with, and which lighted a chamber forming part of what were called the little apartments. For the rest, a joyous beam of the sun, for the sun appeared to care little for the loss France had just suffered, a sunbeam, we say, descended upon them, drawing perfumes from the neighboring flowers and animating the walls themselves. These two persons, so occupied, not by the death of the Duke, but by the conversation which was the consequence of that death, were a young woman and a young man. The latter personage, a man of from 25 to 26 years of age, with a mien sometimes lively and sometimes dull, making good use of two large eyes, shaded with long eyelashes, was short of stature and swart of skin. He smiled with an enormous but well-furnished mouth, and his pointed chin, which appeared to enjoy a mobility nature does not ordinarily grant to that portion of the countenance, leant from time to time very lovingly towards his interlocutrix, who, we must say, did not always draw back so rapidly as strict propriety had a right to require. The young girl, we know her, for we have already seen her at that very same window by the light of that same sun. The young girl presented a singular mixture of shyness and reflection. She was charming when she laughed, beautiful when she became serious, but let us hasten to say she was more frequently charming than beautiful. These two appear to have attained the culminating point of a discussion half bantering, half serious. "Now, Monsieur Malicorne," said the young girl, "does it at length please you that we should talk reasonably?" "You believe that that is very easy, Mademoiselle Orr," replied the young man. "To do what we like, when we can only do what we are able." "Good, there he is bewildered in his phrases." "Who, I?" "Yes, you quit that lawyer's logic, my dear." "Another impossibility." "Clerk I am, Mademoiselle de Montalais." "Demoiselle I am, Monsieur Malicorne." "Alas, I know it well, and you overwhelm me by your rank, so I will say no more to you." "Well, no, I don't overwhelm you. Say what you have to tell me, say it, I insist upon it." "Well, I obey you." "That is truly fortunate." "Monsieur is dead." "Ah, peste, that's news. And where do you come from, to be able to tell us that?"
"I come from Orleans, mademoiselle."
"And is that all the news you bring?"
"Ah, no. I am come to tell you that Madame Henrietta of England is coming to marry the king's brother."
"Indeed, Malicorne, you are insupportable with your news of the last century. Now mind, if you persist in this bad habit of laughing at people, I will have you turned out."
"Oh."
"Yes, for really you exasperate me."
"There, there.
Patience, mademoiselle. You want to make yourself of consequence, I know well enough why. Go.
Tell me, and I will answer you frankly, yes, if the thing be true.
You know that I am anxious to have that commission of Lady of Honor, which I have been foolish enough to ask of you, and you do not use your credit."
"Who, I?"
Malicorne cast down his eyes, joined his hands, and assumed his sullen air. "And what credit can the poor clerk of a procureur have, pray? Your father has not 20,000 livres a year for nothing, M. Malicorne."
"A provincial fortune, Mademoiselle de Montalais."
"Your father is not in the secrets of Monsieur le Prince for nothing."
"An advantage which is confined to lending Monson your money."
"In a word, you are not the most cunning young fellow in the province for nothing."
"You flatter me."
"Who, I?"
"Yes, you."
"How so?"
"Since I maintain that I have no credit, and you maintain I have."
"Well then, my commission?"
"Well, your commission?"
"Shall I have it, or shall I not?"
"You shall have it."
"Aye, but when?"
"When you like."
"Where is it then?"
"In my pocket."
"How, in your pocket?"
"Yes."
And with a smile, Malicorne drew from his pocket a letter, upon which Mademoiselle seized as a prey and which she read eagerly. As she read, her face brightened. Malicorne,
cried she after having read it, in truth you are a good lad.
What for, mademoiselle?
Because you might have been paid for this commission, and you have not. And she burst into a loud laugh, thinking to put the clerk out of countenance, but Malicorne sustained the attack bravely.
I do not understand. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.